Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Think Higher, Feel Deeper, Holocaust Education in the Secondary Classroom, by Mark Gudgel, narrated by Barry Abrams. Publisher's note: in this audio edition, you will hear references to illustrations and tables present in the print and ebook formats of this book. Forward. When Mark Gudgel invited me to write the foreword for his book, I answered as I always answer: let me read it, and then I will decide. Since I was staying in a cabin in the woods of upstate New York, I had no access to a printer, so I opened Think Higher, Feel Deeper, Holocaust Education in the Secondary Classroom with some trepidation, as, being of my generation, I did not really want to read a book on the computer, but I was immediately impressed with what I read. I respect good teachers, and I revere those teachers who go beyond the curriculum, beyond the requirements of tests and mandates, and offer themselves and their subject matter to their students, determined to engage them in the subject matter and to enrich them as people. Mark is that type of teacher. First and foremost, he respects the subject matter of the Holocaust and admonishes both his students and his readers, in the work of my distinguished colleague and friend John K. Roth, to handle with care. He understands the power of this material and understands that its power can be used destructively to shatter or constructively to inform its students intellectually, move them emotionally, and transform them humanely. The Holocaust is such an event, and any good teacher who has taught this material understands its power. Mark urges caution and restraint, but offers his fellow teachers imaginative ways to engage their students and enhance their experience. We can learn from him what to do in the classroom, and also how to take the Holocaust from the classroom into the world, as well as bring the world into the classroom. Mark is a committed and enthusiastic learner as well, enhancing his knowledge by reading and traveling, by engaging his subject matter, and by exploring with other teachers how to be most effective. For him, teaching is a calling, not a job. His deepest calling is to teach the Holocaust not only for its own sake, but also for its transformative power to touch the souls of his students and to allow them to deal with some significant, dare I say, ultimate issues of life and death and the controversial issues of racism, antisemitism, prejudice, and persecution. Issues that some teachers are afraid to confront because they are disturbing and potentially disruptive. But in the hands of a skilled teacher, dealing with these issues can engage the students with the realities they face. Many of us remember those moments when we were students, when the learning became real rather than rote, when we walked out of the classroom with a sense of elation, when teaching and learning made a difference in our lives, when the teacher spoke to our souls. After all these years, Mark remains passionate about what he does and committed to offering his students opportunities to travel. I marveled at his students' encounter with Elie Wiesel, who, despite, not because of, all his accomplishments in literature and culture, in politics and world affairs, liked to describe himself as a teacher not out of sense of modesty, but out of sense of reverence for what real teaching offers. When Wiesel said, "From one teacher to another, to Mark," he revealed the core of his own identity and Mark's. As one of the creators of the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum, I felt a particular gratification in his depiction of bringing students to the museum for a visit and the impact of the museum and its various educational outreach programs on Mark. The vision of what we once dreamed possible has become a reality, and Mark is one of its exemplars. How should one read this book? Some advice: take the title seriously. Allow yourself to think higher and feel deeper. What an audacious title and a terrific challenge to those of us who teach, especially to secondary school teachers, who go at it day after day, period after period, year after year, with but modest pay and limited recognition. Mark has reminded us all of the reasons we teach: to reach students and transform them, enlarge their horizons, empower them to grow, and in Mark's case, make them not only informed citizens, but better people. Martin Buber wrote of the role of a teacher: "Some teachers make students enthusiastic about themselves. However important, that is the task of the social worker. Other teachers make their students enthusiastic about them. That, too, is important, but it is the task of a performer. A true teacher makes their students enthusiastic about the subject matter, and by engaging them, enables them to affirm themselves and their teacher. Mark does all that and more." Mark often raises more questions than answers. Thus, he is faithful to his subject matter. The Holocaust resists simple answer and raises significant questions. We must share our questions with our students and introduce them to a world that resists easy answers. Questions can be pursued together. Join Mark in pursuing the questions. Share them with your students. Magic can happen in your classroom as well. Michael Berenbaum, American Jewish University, Los Angeles. Introduction. Tolerance is condescending. Who am I to tolerate your views? I should respect your views. Who knows? They may be better than my own. Elie Wiesel, 2012 A. The question flitted about nervously in my head, as if it wished to escape. I had been waiting all year to ask this single question of a single individual of whom I am not ashamed to admit I was perpetually in awe. My students and I stood anxiously in a large side room adorned with modern artwork at the 92nd Street Y in New York City, far from our homes in Lincoln, Nebraska. A few of my colleagues, teachers like me, had joined us, along with my student teacher, Melissa. We were 25 in all, maybe 26, the number agreed upon months ago when the planning for this annual excursion had begun. A few young men had failed to heed my directive and wore T-shirts, and later I would be too hard on them. But most of my students looked as if they were on their way to worship, or perhaps a homecoming dance. My own suit didn't fit particularly well. I had not yet discovered tailors. Mr. Wiesel's personal assistant, a tall, slender woman with straight, dark hair, high cheekbones, and kind eyes, entered the room and smiled at us. She was accompanied by the director of the 92nd Street Y, a jovial, bearded man. The two of them were yet again largely responsible for our being there. This was maybe the third or fourth time in as many years that I had brought students to this place for this reason, and by now I knew and appreciated them both deeply. "He'll be in just a moment," his assistant beamed at my students with an assuring nod, still wearing her smile with ease. They shifted their weight, and many looked to me in anticipation. I smiled reassuringly. When Professor Elie Wiesel, Holocaust survivor and Nobel laureate, whose memoir Night was deeply meaningful to my students and me, at last entered the room from a door on the opposite wall from the one we had used, silence rang out like a gong. My students stopped breathing. All whispers evaporated. He made his way to his seat, pausing to take a hand and exchange a kindness along the way, and sat down, my students, and only my students, surrounding him. "Well?" he asked them at last in his famously pensive voice. "What do you want to know?" Professor Wiesel and I had gotten to know one another by writing letters back and forth, and he had invited me years earlier to bring students to see him in New York, an opportunity I had jumped at without hesitation. Originally, I estimated that I'd bring 5 students, and the plan was to do it one time. That was years ago, and every year after that I had come to hear him speak with around 25 kids and a handful of teacher chaperones, mostly my fellow Literature of the Holocaust teachers. He would patiently answer my students' questions, sign our books, and in his own powerful way make a group of 16-year-olds feel as if he were there to see them rather than the other way around. But my question, although I had written him a note of thanks the year before for seeing us yet again, and while I knew that he would respond on the 5-inch by 7-inch Boston University letterhead he always used, I had resisted the urge to include my question in a letter. Now, a year later, I again had the opportunity to ask him in person. As he concluded his talk with my students, we again met to shake hands. My own clasped in both of his, he graciously thanked me for bringing students all the way from Nebraska, although I always felt quite clearly that I was the one indebted. When it was my turn to speak, I at last released my query. What advice would you give me as a teacher? He paused for only a moment, so short it might not have even been a pause at all. Just enough time for a subtle movement of his head, slightly upward toward my own. Then he responded, "Think higher, feel deeper." It was the last time I ever saw him. I have been contemplating his advice ever since. This is not an academic text in the strictest definition of the phrase. I am proud to be able to say that my doctoral dissertation, which focuses on how film is used to teach about the Holocaust in American secondary schools, is one of the rare such pieces of writing not completely damned to obscurity. My work is cited occasionally, not bad for a doctoral dissertation, mostly, I suspect, because it is one of the few pieces of research, perhaps the only one, that actually deals with the topic writ large. This book, on the other hand, is for teachers, and I want it to be read and used. I'll cite my sources so you can access them yourself, but I also intend to write in the first person and to tell stories like the one that I have just told. My friend Carl says stories bring people together, and I believe he's right. If you want a more academic treatment of the Holocaust or education, well, there's certainly no shortage elsewhere. Neither do I intend this to be a comprehensive how-to guide for teaching about the Holocaust. I wouldn't have the audacity to write such a thing. The Holocaust is probably the best documented event in human history, and the number of angles, topics, and approaches that teachers may utilize successfully would fill many, many books. Perhaps it would be best to characterize this book, then, as what I wish I had known when I set out to teach about this topic. Or, better still, what I've learned about teaching about the Holocaust over nearly 2 decades of doing it. What follows this introduction is a chapter-by-chapter presentation of topics I have selected that represent the information and advice that I think I would have benefited the most from knowing when I began my career as a Holocaust educator. I have been teaching for 17 years, which guarantees me membership in the proverbial old guard among educators. I wonder, if everyone had the opportunity to teach about something as important as the Holocaust, would they last longer in our profession? And so, to my colleagues, my hope is that you'll read this book and that it will make the difficult, often daunting task of approaching the Holocaust in your classroom somewhat more manageable. It will never be easy. It shouldn't be. But it can be done accurately, efficaciously, meaningfully, and in such a way that it edifies and empowers rather than drains, bores, or causes despair. This is as important for ourselves as it is for our students. Furthermore, I want to be useful, and I hope that this book is that. My personal email address is mark.gudgel, G-U-D-G-E-L, @yahoo.com. If I can assist you at any time as you strive to make man's inhumanity to man a part of your lessons, to grapple with that notion with your students, I hope you'll reach out. As someone who has been teaching about this complicated, important subject for the entirety of my professional career, I welcome you into the fold, and I thank you for what I can only assume will be your very best efforts. You will have triumphs, and you will have failures. You will have phone calls from concerned parents, meetings with administrators, and frustrated and frustrating emails. You will have students who appear not to care, or worse, may even tell you that they don't, but not many. All of this is all but certain. You will also go home every night knowing that what you are doing is quite profound and profoundly meaningful to most of your students. They will follow up with you over the years that come, thanking you for what you taught them. They will email you pictures of themselves with human rights experts whom they went to see on their college campus because you mentioned them in your class. They will credit you with influencing their choice of major or minor, or their decision to join the Peace Corps. They will send you articles from news outlets that reminded them of your class and which they believe you will enjoy. They will meet you for coffee on summer break or drop by unannounced to visit you at school. And in each of these exchanges, it will be reinforced for you that teaching about the Holocaust is not the same thing as teaching about most other topics. There is an inherent power that lies in memory, a significance embedded in the words we use to formulate our thoughts about the ugliest chapter of human history, and a wind that can fill our sails and thrust us powerfully forward through life and toward a better future, so long as our teachers have shown us how to grip the rudder. Most of all, there will be countless opportunities, both for our students and for ourselves, to think higher and to feel deeper. My hope is that this book will help you to seize still more of those opportunities. Chapter 1. Defining and Contextualizing the Holocaust with Young People. If you want to become a better teacher of the Holocaust. Peter Fredlake, Personal Communication. So, I heard you're a Holocaust survivor. I turned around, startled. Either the speaker was talking to me, in which case they were badly misinformed, or else they were addressing someone else whom I either already knew or badly wanted to meet. It turned out, unfortunately, that the former was the case. I was the one being spoken to. However, I quickly ascertained that the comment was sarcasm, and her encouraging smile suggested an inside joke of some kind. The look on my face clearly prompted her to explain herself. "That's what one of your students said in class yesterday," she told me. I was horrified. Of course, this was a tremendous misunderstanding, but where could it have originated? I racked my brain. How could a student of mine have concluded that a man in his mid-30s had survived the Holocaust? It was 2014, maybe 2015 at the time, and I was born in the United States in 1981. Where would they get that idea? I stammered. I think it's from your tattoos, chimed in another voice. True enough, my arms are tattooed, and I don't always wear long sleeves. Still, my tattoos say things like, "We the people," with the word "people" filled in with the colors of the rainbow. There's nothing there to invoke the tattoos that were forced upon some inmates at Auschwitz-Birkenau. You told them you were in Auschwitz, said the first teacher. At least, that's what our mutual student said. And then I remembered. The day before, I had shared with students a few pictures of my visit to Auschwitz back in 2009 as part of a program put on by the Polish government. Still, the misunderstanding was almost unfathomable, ink on my arms or not. Maybe they thought you survived one of the other Holocausts, offered the third teacher. I opened my mouth to object, couldn't decide where to start, and walked out of the curriculum center feeling as if I had a ton of work to do. What are we talking about when we talk about the Holocaust? Students come to the topic of the Holocaust with varying degrees of knowledge and varying levels of interest. Some clearly know next to nothing, although I regularly repeat to them, "I don't fault you for what you don't know, though I may fault those who knew and didn't tell you." I think that we can all identify a period of time in our minds, perhaps the Renaissance, the Middle Ages, or the Roman Empire, when the decades run together. Thus, I think we can empathize with young people who think of the Holocaust as something that happened long ago and far away, although how long ago and how far away is something about which they sometimes remain uncertain. As a teacher, I find it helpful to remember that what I think people should know is entirely unimportant. What they do know and what I can teach them is all that matters. More troubling by far in my thinking than a teenager believing that I might be old enough to have lived during World War II, or perhaps not connecting World War II to the Holocaust, was the remark about other Holocausts by my colleague. And here, as teachers, I think it is important that we recognize that there are no other Holocausts, because Holocaust should not be used synonymously with the word genocide. There were around a dozen genocides in the 20th century alone, although the legal definition of what constitutes genocide is sometimes in dispute. But there was only one Holocaust. This distinction doesn't mean that genocides not called Holocaust don't matter, or matter less. It merely gives us the precision of language we need to more meaningfully and more accurately approach these difficult, complicated topics. Having a precise definition of the Holocaust thus becomes a paramount objective and a good place to begin. What are we talking about when we talk about the Holocaust? The definition and scope of the event has been debated by many, and for quite some time. Does the Holocaust include non-Jewish victims of the Nazis? Why or why not? Who are the Jews anyway, and why were they singled out in Germany during this time? These questions are of the greatest importance when striving to teach young people about the Shoah, which is the Hebrew term for the Holocaust. Hereafter, I will use these terms interchangeably. Comparing definitions of the Holocaust. To begin a book like this, we must begin with a brief discussion about how to define the Holocaust, and while there may remain some disagreement on the matter, perhaps we can also come to some mutual understandings. The fact that ongoing scholarly debate exists regarding the parameters of the Holocaust necessitates laying out some of the most notable definitions. To offer one singular interpretation would exclude those who hold differing views for entirely valid reasons. The United States Holocaust Memorial Museum, USHMM, is America's leading source of scholarship and educational materials related to the Shoah. In full disclosure, I was an employee of the museum for 6 years as a member of a team called the Regional Education Corps. The USHMM defines the event thus. The Holocaust was the systematic, bureaucratic, state-sponsored persecution and murder of 6 million Jews by the Nazi regime and its collaborators. Holocaust is a word of Greek origin meaning sacrifice by fire. The Nazis, who came to power in Germany in January 1933, believed that Germans were racially superior and that the Jews, deemed inferior, were an alien threat to the so-called German racial community. During the era of the Holocaust, German authorities also targeted other groups because of their perceived racial and biological inferiority. Roma, gypsies, people with disabilities, and some of the Slavic peoples, Poles, Russians, and others. Other groups were persecuted on political, ideological, and behavioral grounds, among them communists, socialists, Jehovah's Witnesses, and homosexuals. This iteration of the definition is not what was crafted originally, nor is it what we used when I worked at the museum, although it is similar. I would not be at all surprised if the historians and others working there continue to change it slightly over time to reflect the most recent scholarship. There are those who oppose or take some amount of umbrage with the notion that the Jews were the primary victims of the Nazi killing apparatus, although this is a historical fact. The Imperial War Museum, IWM, in London is similar to the USHMM in that it does a lot to offer resources for educators and it has a permanent exhibition devoted to the Holocaust. However, it should be noted that the Shoah is but a part of what the IWM exhibition focuses on, whereas with the USHMM and many other institutions, the Holocaust is the singular point of focus. The IWM has a somewhat different definition for the Holocaust. The Holocaust was the systematic murder of Europe's Jews by the Nazis and their collaborators during the Second World War. For the first time in history, industrial methods were used for the mass extermination of a whole people. Between 1933 and 1945, Jews were targeted for discrimination, segregation, and extermination. On coming to power in 1933, the Nazis began to actively persecute the Jews of Germany with the introduction of discriminatory legislation accompanied by vicious anti-Semitic propaganda. With the outbreak of the Second World War in 1939, the process escalated and Jews throughout Nazi-controlled Europe came under the threat of death. The German invasion of the Soviet Union in June 1941 was accompanied by the mass shootings of Jews by mobile killing squads, Einsatzgruppen, made up of Nazis and local collaborators. In 1942, following the Wannsee Conference of senior Nazi officials, the Nazis began the methodical deportation and extermination of Europe's Jews. Trains transported them from ghettos and other holding centers to extermination or labor camps, where they were gassed, shot, or worked to death. In some ways, the definition used by the IWM is strikingly similar to that of the USHMM, but there are some noteworthy variations. An interesting activity for a sharp group of kids is to sit them down with multiple definitions side by side and have them examine the similarities and differences in each, perhaps discussing what may lead to points of agreement or tension between them. Yad Vashem, Israel's Holocaust Museum, which hosts the International School for Holocaust Studies, uses a different definition from the first two we have seen. In Hebrew, Shoah, the name used in English to refer to the systematic destruction of European Jewry at the hands of the Nazis during World War II. The word Holocaust comes from the Greek word holokauston, which is a translation of the Hebrew word olah. During biblical times, an olah was a type of sacrifice to God that was totally consumed or burnt by fire. Over time, the word Holocaust came to be used with reference to large-scale slaughter or destruction. The Hebrew word Shoah, which has the connotation of a whirlwind of destruction, was first used in 1940 to refer to the extermination of the Jews of Europe in a booklet published in Jerusalem by the United Aid Committee for the Jews in Poland. The booklet was titled Shoat Yehude Polin, the Holocaust of the Jews of Poland. It included articles and eyewitness reports on the persecution of Eastern European Jewry that began when World War II broke out in September 1939. The reports were written or dictated by Jews who had seen what was going on and escaped, including some prominent Polish Jewish leaders. However, the term Shoah was hardly used until the spring of 1942. Instead, many Yiddish-speaking Jews used the term Churban, which also means destruction or catastrophe, and historically refers to the destruction of the ancient holy temples in Jerusalem, both in 586 BCE and in 70 CE. In the spring of 1942, a historian in Jerusalem, Ben-Zion Dinur, used the word Shoah with reference to the extermination of European Jewry, and called it a catastrophe that showed how different and unique the Jewish people were from the rest of the world. Other Jews in Palestine soon began using the term Shoah to describe the destruction of the European Jewish community. By the 1950s, the English term Holocaust came to be employed as the term for the murder of the Jews in Europe by the Nazis. although the term is sometimes used with reference to the murder of other groups by the Nazis, strictly speaking, those groups do not belong under the heading of the Holocaust, nor are they included in the generally accepted statistic of 6 million victims of the Holocaust. It makes sense, of course, that the definition of the Holocaust used by the museum housed in the Jewish state, a state re-established largely by those who survived the Nazis a mere 3 years after the conclusion of the Second World War, would place distinct emphasis on Jewish identity and Jewish victims of the Holocaust. Israel as a nation, re-established in 1948, was in some ways the result of the Holocaust, and the identities of those who founded the modern state of Israel are often as inextricably linked to the Shoah as they are to their Jewish cultural and religious heritage. While the third definition may stand out to Western audiences, there is nothing objectionable in it from a scholarly or historical standpoint, and I would be somewhat concerned about the motives of anyone who wanted to argue about other parts of it as well. Each definition is unique and was written by people situated in a certain place, within a certain national context, and at a certain time. Only one definition references communists. Only one references the Einsatzgruppen and Wannsee Conference. And only one references the fall of the temples. Each point of emphasis reflects the different perspectives and priorities of those creating the definition, and while each institution is situated in a different place, time, and context, each definition is nevertheless accurate. While the similarities and differences among these three definitions are indeed striking, what is most valuable for educators is to consider the context and the reasons why they hold such similarities and differences. The Echoes and Reflections Teacher Resource Guide, which is a joint project between the Anti-Defamation League, the USC Shoah Foundation at the University of Southern California, and Yad Vashem, actually provides these definitions, in whole or excerpted, as part of its curriculum. This is a useful resource for teachers, as well as for students who may wish to analyze these definitions as part of a somewhat scholarly analysis. One unmistakable commonality that all three definitions emphasize is that the Holocaust was perpetrated against the Jews. The reason for this is that the Jews were in fact the primary targets of the Nazis, the only group identified for wholesale annihilation without exception. USHMM 2020. This should do nothing to diminish the plight of non-Jewish groups who found themselves persecuted and their lives often threatened by the Nazis. Many non-Jews did indeed die during World War II, many of them alongside Jews, and even for similar reasons. In Chapter 7 of this book, the question of these other victims will be addressed. For now, suffice it to say that when we speak of the Holocaust accurately, we are speaking first and foremost of the annihilation of European Jews at the hands of the Nazi regime. Defining Jews and Judaism. The question of who is a Jew can be a difficult one to answer. To begin with, it may be helpful to state that saying someone is a Jew is not derogative or an insult, unless context or tone of voice makes it so. Albert Einstein was a Jew. Jerry Seinfeld still is a Jew. As a colleague of mine in Amsterdam once put it, you don't need to say Jewish person. Nothing other than a person can be Jewish. This, however, doesn't get us any nearer to answering the question of which persons are Jews. A Jew may be best understood as someone who practices Judaism, although on more than one occasion, I've heard Jewish people, including more than one rabbi, profess to believing that the Jews are a race. It is difficult as a Gentile to argue with a rabbi, but on this point, I am somewhat inclined to do so. There is indeed an ethnic component to Jewish identity. It is traditionally held that if one's mother is Jewish, then one is Jewish, a matrilineal heritage of sorts. In addition, there is the cultural part of Judaism, which allows one to be a secular Jew. I do not claim to have a perfect answer to this question, although reinforcing for students that identity is indeed a complicated thing has proven over time to be a good place to start. It is also important to acknowledge the internal diversity of Judaism as a religion. There are myriad traditions within this singular faith, with differing opinions and beliefs held by each. From an academic standpoint, Harvard's Pluralism Project offers the most concise and useful definition for Judaism I've ever found. Simply put, Judaism is the way of life of the Jewish people. In the English-speaking Western world, Judaism is often considered a religion, but there are no equivalent words for Judaism or for religion in Hebrew. There are words for faith, law, or custom, but not for religion if one thinks of the term as meaning solely the beliefs and practices associated with a relationship with God or a vision of transcendence. The Jewish tradition is much broader than this. As a way of life, it includes the social, cultural, and religious history of a widespread and diverse community, including people who do and do not think of themselves as religious. Explaining how Nazi racial ideology distorted Judaism. Equally important, especially in the context of the topic at hand, that is, the Shoah, is the fact that the Nazis sought to redefine Jews and Judaism during their 12-year reign over Germany. The notion of race and space drove Nazi ideology, and this required that the expansion and seizure of greater Lebensraum, living space, be justified by an expanding population. That population was the German race, although we would think of German more naturally as a nationality. The irony that this notion of a German race, the Aryans, was perpetuated first and foremost by Adolf Hitler, an Austrian with very few of the physical characteristics ascribed to the so-called Aryan race, is a point that students are quick to make and want to dwell upon. I suggest that you let them. It is but one of many windows into the soul of Nazi ideology, which, when peered through, is revealed to make no rational sense at all. Simply put, the Nazis were driven by hatred and the pursuit of power, and the pseudo-sciences they employed were merely part of their weak attempt to justify their ambitions. The Jewish race that this Austrian and others worked so hard to demonize was, at the time the Nazis came to power, a largely assimilated population within Germany, making up less than 0.5% of German citizens. One goal of Nazi propaganda, then, was to take this assimilated population and turn it into a visible enemy. I often challenge my students during this conversation to think about themselves and others that they know. Some of their friends and family are deeply religious, while others hold strongly nationalistic beliefs. One person may be a devout Christian who happens to live in the United States, while another may identify as an American who, if pressed, attends church with their parents on Christmas and Easter. The same was true in Germany at the time that Hitler came to power. There was no shortage of men who fought in the First World War and were devoted to Germany, while being faintly aware that their mother's parents were Jews. Similarly, there were devout Jews who merely happened to live in Germany. In 1935, the Nuremberg Laws formally took away any chance of self-identifying by offering a strict legal framework that defined who was and who was not Jewish. Authored in part by Wilhelm Stuckart, who would later attend the Wannsee Conference, where the final solution was implemented, the laws go back generations to determine who is a Jew from a legal standpoint and to offer different classifications of Jews with mixed lineage. This legal framework, which defined Jews solely as a race, helped set the stage for their persecution and murder. For this and other reasons, I encourage educators to avoid defining either secular or religious Judaism in racial terms. As one of my students once aptly put it, you can't convert to being black. Helping non-Jewish students understand Jews and Judaism. With all this in mind, telling students what a Jew isn't falls far short of telling them who the Jews are. I strongly encourage that any unit on the Holocaust begin with a cultural study of Judaism. History, holidays, scripture, traditions, cuisine, all these things and more can come together to help students understand Jews and Judaism in a more meaningful way, assuming they don't already. The religion wing of the Jewish Virtual Library offers a useful overview of holidays and more. In addition, the organization Facing History and Ourselves has a great segment on its website to help students think about identity titled Being Jewish in the United States. Further, a visit from a local rabbi, a visit to a synagogue, or merely tapping into some of the readily available resources from the USHMM and other reputable sources can help teachers introduce Jewish culture in a way that makes the study of the Holocaust far more meaningful. I would add, however, that we must strive not to make a single person the representative of an entire faith, insofar as this may be possible. As with so many things in teaching, balance is important here as well. An essential element to help students learn and take away from this study is the diversity of cultures represented in pre-World War II Jewish life. The European Jewry of this period ranged from assimilated German Jews to Ashkenazi settlements in Eastern Europe and countless others, each culture unique and distinct from the rest. The Jews of Europe were at least as, if not far more diverse than, the people of Europe, and most students will appreciate that Spanish, Hungarian, and Danish cultures are all quite different from one another. It is less important that students study each distinct Jewish culture than that they be aware that there were numerous unique Jewish cultures within every country of Europe and the entire world at that time. The internal diversity of Judaism, with an added degree of complexity attributed to national and regional distinctions, makes pre-World War II Jewish life a topic both vast and deep. Exploring layers of history. An important aspect of the study of pre-World War II Jewish life is the seemingly obvious fact that all Jews around the world who would be affected by the Holocaust were not sitting around waiting for it to happen. The Jews did not spring into being in 1919 or 1932, or whenever the curriculum suggests we begin. The Holocaust arrived in different places at different times, and looked very different through the eyes of the 6 million who were murdered and the millions more who were not. It was, in this way, a highly individualized experience. One example to help understand this that has always struck me comes from Elie Wiesel's introduction to fellow survivor Sam Halpern's memoir, titled Darkness and Hope. Wiesel writes, "I was liberated by the Red Army on March 22, 1944. That is how Sam Halpern opens his poignant and moving narrative about his wartime and post-war experiences. I read and reread this deceptively simple sentence. I stop at the date, and I am shocked by its implied significance. When his nightmare was over, mine hadn't yet begun. In fact, we knew nothing about its horror-laden dimensions." The Jews of Sighet, the town in Transylvania where Elie Wiesel was born, were deported to Auschwitz, an event with which many are familiar from Wiesel's poignant descriptions of it in Night between May 17th and 21st, 1944. Sam Halpern and his brother Ari had been imprisoned in Kamionka, a village in eastern Poland that at that time housed a forced labor camp. They escaped the camp and hid in a hayloft until the Red Army arrived. Of the 2,000 Jews the Halpern brothers had grown up around in their shtetl of Korostkov, only 26 survived the Nazi mechanisms of death. Thus, Sam and Ari were free prior to Wiesel and his family being deported to Auschwitz, in what is today the western side of Poland, near Krakow. In reality, the layers of history, the complexity and internal diversity of Judaism, and the seemingly impossible timelines that become a part of this study can be enough to overwhelm teachers and students. My suggestion to teachers is to mention these things, to do what you can to individualize the Holocaust, but to select stories, memoirs, and materials that perhaps resonate with you personally, about which you are more passionate and knowledgeable than others. My colleague Paul, who established the Literature of the Holocaust course I taught in Lincoln Public Schools for a decade, used to talk about planting seeds of curiosity, and that resonates with me. The Holocaust is an unfathomably complex topic. We cannot, as teachers, in the very limited amounts of time in which we seek to introduce this topic to our students, hope to cover it exhaustively. Instead, we must pick and choose those parts that we ourselves can make most interesting, those parts that will be, by virtue of context and community, most meaningful to our students, and plant those as the seeds that we hope will blossom into curiosity and lifelong learning about the Shoah. I was leaning against the edge of the swimming pool at my apartment complex. The high school where I then taught was so close by that, if not for a few...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.